Ja, ich begrüße euch alle ganz herzlich und muss schon sagen, wir haben das gerade noch mal besprochen.
Welcome, everyone. We just discussed, well, we're glad that so many of you have come, you know, looking at the weather outside, and also we are on our fourth day at this conference. I just wanted to make a few technical remarks before we start.
Deutsch ist, if you Kanal 2 Englisch und Kanal 4 Spanisch.
Channel 2 is for English and Channel 4 is for Spanish. Another quick announcement. Tomorrow from 9 o'clock on, we need more helpers that help us to clean up everything. So maybe some of you are still free tomorrow morning to help us out to clean up after our conference. Now, we've come together here to talk about the relation between basic income, unconditional basic income, and a degrowth society. And our panelists, I'm Dagmar Paternoga, I'm a member of ATTAC, also of the Council of ATTAC.
And I've been dealing with the issue in
We've had a conference on that issue in Berlin, the Congress Beyond Growth, and we have here with us tonight Margit Apel, first of all. She's a political scientist, a sociologist, and she's active in women's research and women's studies. And she's head of social policy, societal policy, at her institution. And she's also a member of BN Austria and Unconditional Basic Income Network in Austria. Vincent Légis is also with us. He's a member of Unconditional Auto Allowance. He's a speaker, spokesperson for the French degrowth movement, and he's currently doing his PhD. And Werner Reetz is a political scientist, active in the Association Informationsstelle Lateinamerika in Bonn. He's a co-founder of ATTAC Germany and member of the coordinating committee of ATTAC. And he's also a member of the Unconditional Basic Income Europe, which is a European network. And he also works for the national working group, ATTAC working group, Beyond Growth. And also in the working group Genug für alle, Enough for All, where the concept, the ATTAC concept for the basic income was developed. Vincent will take the floor first to actually present his idea, his proposal for the basic income. Basic autonomy for income and infrastructure.
The organizers of this conference, I think it's really, really a fantastic organization. It's really and it's really great to be here and to see so many young people, so many people who are coming to have discussion about degrowth, and in particular for people like me who've been involved in the degrowth movement for years and who are experiencing this terrible contradiction to experience a growth crisis, because I think we are maybe too many people to have a convivial time, but let's enjoy it. And I also would like to thank the interpreters. I will try to be as slow as possible, like the snail which is behind me, but it's very difficult for me to speak about degrowth very slowly, because I am always very enthusiastic when I start to speak about that. So I have a limited time, and it's good because degrowth is also about looking back for limits and to get rid of this hubris. And I will try to present the main lines about what we develop in this book called The Degrowth Project, and this idea of unconditional autonomy allowance. And first, what I want to say is that degrowth in the first time of its life in France and a bit everywhere was really great to criticize and deconstruct the growth paradigm, the growth mania, the growth religion. And we were very weak to suggest proposals. And when we participated first to European elections in 2009 in France, we started to realize that we don't have so much to propose. And that's where we started to implement discussion about what could be a degrowth project. So it's not the degrowth project, because we have to respect, and I think it's very fundamental and important for degrowth, the diversity of approaches, of initiatives, of proposal, of experimentations, and so on. So it's just some ideas what we spread, coming from the French degrowth movement, and we put it in trying to make a synthesis in a book. And when we started to speak about what could be a degrowth project, we started to realize that, in fact, the transition is already underway. We can really see it in this conference. There is a dynamics in our society where people start to take a distance with growth mania, start to decolonize their imaginary, start to leave more voluntary simplicity, to get rid of this always consume more, always more pressure, stress, work, and so on, and try to reappropriate some freedom, some conviviality, some autonomy, some meaningful lives. And also we realize that the transition is underway with all the concrete alternatives and the great dynamics we can observe everywhere in the world, with all this creativity, local initiatives, where we experiment what could be tomorrow degrowth society, with community support of agriculture, local currency, transition initiatives, permaculture, do-it-yourself movement, and so on and so on. It's full of initiatives everywhere in the world. And we said that, okay, the transition is already going on, but when we started to look at each other, people involved in such initiatives, if we look at each other tonight in the room, we're going to see the same. Everybody is quite more or less not so much representative to the society. We represent just a small part of the society. And we started to question why not more people are involved in such transition, such initiatives. And we realized that there is something which is really dominating most of the people in this society, that's the fear, economic fear. We are living, moreover, since 2008, and the trap, the lie of the debt crisis with that austerity plans in a big fear, a fear to lose the job, to don't be able to pay back the loan for the car, the loan for the flat, to lose the flat, and so on. And we are living in very individualistic societies where there is no solidarity anymore, but just everyday survival dynamics. And we started to speak, to think about how to find solution to reappropriate autonomy, to repoliticize the society, to reappropriate hope in being free from this fear pressure. And that's where we started to speak about this idea of unconditional basic income. So to give from birth to death what would be enough. So we need a basic income which is enough unconditionally to any participation to a forced labor, which would be enough to have a decent life. And we also started to think about other tools which could be interesting for this idea to repoliticize the society, like local currencies, like local economic system, where we question what do we produce, how do we produce it, for what kind of use. And the other point we were interested in when we started to speak about the degrowth project, it was the fact that we are facing, if you look at history, maybe the biggest inequalities. There was a study published a few months ago by Oxfam NGO saying that 1% of the people in the world are owning 50% of the goods. And in companies in France, there is a difference from 1 to 4,000 between the minimum, the lowest salaries and the biggest salaries. And in such societies, when there are such inequalities, we cannot accept that, because the first of degrowth should be the degrowth in inequalities. Obviously because of social and environmental justice, and also because of symbolic reasons. We should, because human beings are social animals, they compare themselves with their neighbors, and when we have TVs, we compare ourselves with what is put on the TV, so the way of life of the richest people, which should, based on what we can hear on advertisement, TVs, and so on, that it's an illusion, that it's an objective in itself to reach some happiness. So it creates a lot of frustration in the society. It creates a lot of hatred. It creates a lot of differences of perception of the things between the people. So we cannot have a direct democracy in a society where people are not experiencing the same. And to connect it to this idea of maximum income, which should be implemented to reduce the inequalities, we started to speak also about a different type of taxes on things which are counterproductive, on things which are creating this frustration and pushing us to always consume more things what we don't need at all. So that's where we started to criticize the place of advertisement in our society. We started to question, why do we spend so much money on the military industrial complex, the place of planned obsolescence, all the stupid things what we produce we don't need at all, and so on. And the last point we started to speak about when we were thinking about the degrowth project, it was the fact that we live in what we call the religion of economics. We live in societies where our imaginary are totally dominated by Homo economicus, and how to put back economics in its right place, how to get rid of what we can hear and what we can see with that public debt trap. We think that economics, public debt, it's something which is above politics, where it should be a tool to implement transitions. So we started to deal with this idea to implement some public debt audit to understand where this debt from. If we don't pay back the debt, we will lose money. Is it really important to pay back this debt? We started to think about what is money creation, what is a central bank, what's the role of a central bank, what is a private bank, how does it work, and how to have a bigger democratic control, reappropriation of all these economic tools, to use them as tools to implement transitions to what we call degrowth. So I mean more sustainable, desirable, autonomous, convivial models of society. And we put all these ideas a bit all together. So starting from grassroots movement with the transformation of the society, with voluntary simplicity, decolonization of imaginary and local alternatives, and with all these reforms, and we reach this idea of unconditional autonomy allowance, which will be like a basic income, but partially demonetized. So it won't not only be given in cash, in euros, or in local currency, but given also in some rights to have an access to some services, to have an access to some products, and also some local currency, and also some money. So for us, this idea of unconditional autonomy allowance, it's an economic tool, and it's very important, it's just an economic tool, which could be effective, which could be interesting, to push, help, implement the transformation of the society which is already going on. Thank you very much.
Ja, vielen Dank, Vincent. Wir werden heute Abend hier noch zwei andere.
Okay, thank you very much. We will hear two more positions, will maybe convert, but there will be also differences. But I'll now give the floor to Margaret Apple now. Good evening. I'm delighted to be here. I will make a contribution to the topic of tonight. For many years, I've been in the Austrian unconditional basic income, and that income should be unconditional with regard to housing and should also grant social rights. In this debate around unconditional basic income, I always mentioned both. First and foremost, we need an unconditional monetary payment. And on the other hand, we also need non-monetary services, for example, housing, energy, childcare, and health. Now, this path that stands on two legs is inevitable for a society. if I think about unconditional basic income, I think about basic income that should not only bring about more free, more income for people, but also more freedom. And this is a perspective that I really, really like to emphasize on, especially for women. Not only more security but and autonomy, but also more freedom, more life choices. I was asked now in this debate to argue whether one of these two paths, which is one is basic income through monetary payment or through infrastructure, would that be a path towards a post-growth society? Not only looking at these two instruments, the non-monetary infrastructure and the monetary payment, I'm going to see whether these ways can be balanced against each other. Now we're looking at autonomy, emancipation as well. I was invited to join this panel to bring in a feminist perspective, but also social ethics issues as well. And I want to do that and make a preliminary remark, which is important, especially with regard to the challenges that we are faced with. Any form of alternatives that we are envisioning, what we are talking about is the idea that, in historical terms, we are currently in a process of development. A society with unconditional basic income and degrowth should not, or it's not going to be the end of human development. We're talking about an overall development. And in that overall development, what we want is the determination of human freedom and human happiness. And this is permanently that what we want when we develop alternative way of lives. And this is what we are fighting for. Since the modern times, the happiness indicator also includes thinking about the future. And only a few years ago did we understand that we can only think about the future if we also really think about the nature when we consume our resources, our natural resources. William Coase, who was a social ethic, says that we won't gonna have a progress which is not supported by nature. Now, regardless of any alternatives that we are envisioning, we can start to think about this future without being in our own way and without thinking that we need to become better people in order to think about this future and also bring about that transformation. Now, coming back to my initial point, do we have a contradiction between monetary payment and non-monetary infrastructure? In the current capitalist structure, the unconditional income gives us autonomy and power, especially when it comes to work, and also when it comes to ourselves. And when it comes to gender hierarchy, I understand unconditional basic income as strengthening the negotiation power of women, especially when it comes to interrelations and family, and also in their sexual relationships as well, and also via our own selves, our own social constraints and ideologies regarding the gender normativity. Now, the basic income can be a material basis for that what we need, not only to have more negotiation power, but also to have the basis to say no to what one doesn't want to do, especially with regard to the perspective of women. The basic income is not a guarantee. However, it's a potential. It can be seen an instrument that has a high potential to give women more life choices. Even though I don't have time to give you more examples, what becomes very palpable is that life choices cannot be guaranteed for women if, on the other hand, there is no offer for infrastructure, for basic infrastructure, especially when it comes to maintaining life. Therefore, I'd like to highlight the fact that a society with basic income has to have the monetary payment, but also the offer of non-monetary infrastructure. Now, with regard to democracy and distribution issues towards a post-growth society, I really think that a path towards a degrowth society will maybe bring about new ways of consumption and production, maybe new ways of engaging in politics. Now, all these changed societal models should be suitable to also meet the needs of citizens in terms of democracy, in terms of their civil rights, and also offering equal opportunities to citizens in order to evolve in a way they want to. And it is absolutely important to fulfill the needs of citizens. For that, we need structures. We also need a material structure for that. We need enough income, we need enough goods and services, and also enough participation in social wealth in order to be able to influence social life. Now, with regard to distribution in political terms, we need both. I don't want to end in such a harmonized way. I want to I want to intensify my debate here. Now, the question is, monetary, non-monetary infrastructures can they truly have that kind of radicality that monetary payment has? I'm talking about a radicality that offers or guarantees lifestyle choices. Now, when it comes to the negotiation processes to offer autonomy through non-monetary infrastructure, we need to talk about the very important principle of equality is happiness. Now, the basic income in a post-growth society should give people the opportunity to evolve and develop by using the offers and using the infrastructures that are offered to a group or to a certain individual. So the basic income, I believe, especially also with regard to the perspective of women, it is the right to say no, and that for me is important for a post-growth society.
Vielen Dank, Margit.
Thank you very much, Margit. When you look at the relationship between an unconditional basic income and a degrowth society, we can look at it from different perspectives, of course. We can look at social security, more freedom, negotiation power, and it is also about emancipation. These are all aspects that come into play when it comes to this relationship between UBI and a degrowth society. Venerez, what is your perspective on that subject? We came up with a paper in our working group on unconditional basic income.
Darauf einzugehen und nehme ein paar andere Gedanken mit rein, die teilweise auch in unseren Publikationen auftauchen. Auch dazu gibt es oben Auslagen und eines unserer letzten Bücher hier dann eventuell noch zu anschauen.
With the information that I'm going to present here upstairs at the table there. Unconditional basic income has to meet five criteria. Three criteria, there's consensus about three criteria, and a fourth is consensus in the German debate and to a great extent also at the European level, and the fifth is a bit contested. First of all, it has to be an individual payment, no conditions are set and no services have to be rendered in return. This holds particularly true for the duty to be available for employment on the market and no means testing to be performed in advance, setting off the UBI payment against tax liabilities of the previous year and so on. A fourth criteria there's only a partial consensus on that. Vincent has touched upon it. It is a monetary service that has to be high enough, not only to secure material existence, but also to be able to take part or participate in social and cultural life. Now, this is a question not only about a few euros more, but so the amount of the basic income is really crucial. A few years ago, I talked to Works Council members from VW. With 24 of those Works Council members, we had a discussion on basic income. Just imagine you won the lottery and you will receive 1,000 euros per month until your death, and you will have that money available for the rest of your life. Now, please write down one thing, what you would change in your life if you had 1,000 euros guaranteed per month. And a woman said, I would get a divorce. Now, what would you change if you get 400 euros per month? And that is to say that the level of the income, so how much basic income it is it 400 or 1,000, has a great impact on the decisions that people are able to take. There are people who advocate basic income that would be a poverty income or considered a poverty income. That is very hotly debated in Germany. A fifth criteria is even more important. Unconditional basic income has to be an income that is paid to everyone who is in Germany, everyone who is in the respective country, because we cannot exclude anyone. So it applies also to those who don't have the necessary documents, who don't have the papers, because of course you can't have a double standard. You can't pay it to some people and not to others. How this is then organized or arranged, there can be different modes of doing that, but it cannot be a question that they also get the basic income. So the basic income is a project for global transition, global transformation, or it can be a project that for global redistribution, or it can be a means to even exacerbate the exclusionary politics that we see right now, where Europe tries to keep away everyone else. I think basic income, when we look at gross inequalities at a global level has to be a redistribution that enables people in the global south to survive. There are models that have been developed. One of the ATTAC member organizations have made their calculations. Pilot projects have been carried out. These projects have been presented in a couple of workshops here at the conference. So these models are well thought out. A couple of more additional comments. A basic income should not only be a monetary payment. The reason we see, we don't justify that to from a degrowth perspective or from a social ethics perspective. We justify it from an anti-capitalistic perspective. Money is the instrument, is the tool in our current system that plays a very specific role in the capitalist economy, which is to be the commodity of commodities. Every other commodity can be translated into money. And money can be translated into any other commodity. It's the abstract commodity. And as such, it is the tool, or it is the goal or the purpose of any economic activity to accumulate money, create money from create more money with money, is the only purpose, is the single purpose of economic activity. And that is the biggest obstacle to alternative development such as degrowth. There will be no ecological, no socially just, and no equitable earth when this mechanism to create to use money to create more money is not abandoned. And that is why we have to come up with mechanisms, how we can organize alternative mechanisms to organize our economies. And there are a lot of good arguments for the public management of services and goods vis-a-vis private management. And infrastructure also plays an important role, however, a rather limited role. Infrastructure or the basic autonomy by infrastructure means for us that all necessary activities and useful activities can be done, can be carried out when the necessary infrastructure in order to carry out these activities is in place. Creating that infrastructure, the appropriate and necessary infrastructure, is therefore an imperative for parts of society, for example, women, to be able to participate, to actively participate in society. And of course, the basic income has to be coupled with a minimum wage and working time reduction. And basic income should not only get rid of poverty, it should engender creativity in a society. With basic income, they could actually stop doing what they don't want to do, and they could start doing what they actually want to do.
Ich werde als nächstes
Now, what I'm going to do, I'll ask all three panelists a question, which I hope they will answer as well. Afterwards, we'll then start the Q&A session so that the audience has the possibility to ask questions or make comments. And that way, we'll enter in a joint debate. I'd like to ask Margaret Apple the following. Often there is an assumption that if everybody has an unconditional basic income, nobody will want to work anymore. They'll just consume more than before, and that could not lead to a degrowth society. However, we also know, and I'm speaking here in particular about women are carrying out the necessary works in an unpaid manner. And women have always did the care work as well. Now, in a society with a basic income, how do you envision people to also consume in a responsible way? What's your understanding? Well, I'll have a feminist perspective on this. Consumption is a very ambivalent issue here. Under current conditions, we know both. We know the problematic ascription of women. Often women are referred to be consumption junkies, but we also know, and this is not a new stereotype, we also know women who for many years have been also involved in the building up of responsible structure of consumption. So there is an ambivalence, but we have two situations. The two situations are there. But let me highlight one more thing which I want to mention in my work with women who are faced with poverty in Austria. I work in a consultation station where women who are responsible for the care work or for the housework, they are often worried about the people that they care for, not only the children, but also partners and other family members, especially for those who they also have to support financially. So the problem that we know there is that women tend to put their own needs on second place so that they meet the needs of those they are caring for. This affects most the women who are affected by poverty, especially women who have rather low income. And often it's said that these women would consume more if they were to be given an unconditional income, but that's not true. Now let me come back to the idea of freedom, which is so important to me. On one hand, it is appropriate to critically discuss how the question of changing consumption pattern can be successful and how we can move out of or break out of this consumption society and be happy with little. But on the other hand, I also think people should have the liberty to say what they want, even though if it's a luxury, and they should have the means to fulfill that need that they want, and not only not be able to afford that. Because we know very well in Germany or in Austria, especially where we have this repressive social structures, that people who are on unemployment benefits, that they cannot afford certain things. And often their conception decisions are decided by others. And I think we should be really careful to avoid such a perspective in a post-growth society.
Thank you, Margit. I think that ties in very well with the questions of more freedom and more negotiation power and the possibility that is that affords us a basic income without a fear of losing your job, without fear of getting stuck. We could discuss our understanding of a good life. What do we want in our lives? What do we need in our lives? That this will could be part, this would be part of a democratic debate. And men, women, and everyone could actually discuss at eye level these questions, because everyone would be involved, everyone would be able to participate, and everyone would be aware of his or her responsibilities, their responsibilities in society. And my question to Werner Rätz is, sometimes it is said or it is argued that if we have a basic income, no one would work anymore. And the question is also, who would do the care work? Because women do most of the care work. And earlier, sometimes, well, it's often asked also, who would take care of the garbage, for example?
Well, waste is a good example, and waste shows the various possibilities that exist with unwanted work. You can't do waste, basically. You cannot. You can organize the society in such a way that it doesn't produce tendentially so much waste. That would be the perspective, maybe. Now, a path towards that, for it to succeed more, is to just not pick up the garbage. You just leave it there until it stinks. And then that person that it bothers, he or she will clean up the waste. And that happens in our society also every now and then. And if that happens systematically and regularly, then the opportunity for the way the waste to exist less can maybe happen. Now, you can do it, however, differently. Those who are cleaning the garbage, maybe they should be paid better, and then you might maybe find people who will then be able or be willing to clear the waste. Now, with regard to waste, I think this problem can be solved easily. What is more problematic are things that you cannot just leave and not pick up or not do, for example. A feminist economist who was also very involved in the basic income debate, she published in many of our publications, and she talked about the work that one cannot ignore, for example, the ill mother, the crying baby, and that becomes very difficult. And there we see very often that it's the women who then intervene and show responsibility. So if they would not take up that responsibility in the past, would not even exist. Humanity would not even exist. And to think that that care will only happen if people were paid, and it's only something that is absolutely ridiculous. I mean, this, however, is not the perspective that is desirable from a basic income perspective. Now, let me come up with another point which I want to mention here, which is very decisive. Pushing through unconditional basic income and also having a society based on unconditional basic income, that will not come about without struggle. We need harsh struggles to fight for it, and that will also concern gender relations. Unconditional basic income will influence gender relations in such a way that allows those people, especially women who are economically dependent, they will get more freedom. And through having more freedom, it doesn't mean that they truly have more freedom in their lives. They have to fight for it just like any other rights. We have endless rights which we don't actually use. Rosa Luxemburg once said that we all have the right to fly, but we don't all use it. Of course, if you ignore the airplane. So what I'm talking here about is not only to have rights, but also to get the rights. And for that, it will be necessary to develop practices to claim that what is yours. And if you don't get it, just take it, appropriate it. Practices of how people in a large amount, for example, in Spain, that people who are not able to pay houses, that they just appropriate and take the land. And for example, the Global South, where people cannot afford land, they just claim and appropriate the land. So now these confrontations, these struggles, and the democratic debate regarding appropriation is very, very important to get that what you need. And all these struggles and fights are the areas which are necessary. And it's not only about claiming the unconditional basic income, it's about struggling as well. Because when you struggle, places where these kind of struggles are happening, they can change things. Now,
in our struggle against the crisis management of the European Union and the imposed measures of the Troika, and those who join the ecological movement and fights against nuclear power plants, one cannot do that without asking oneself, what does this have to do with myself, with my practices, with my behavior in society? And that opens up a pathway, or opens up you know, opportunities that we can question our own behavior without a movement having to say you're not allowed to do that, you must not do that, this is prohibited. The struggles are the places are where our awareness changes, and reaching out to people so that they join our struggles and movements is the way how to bring about a new society. Thank you very much, Werner. I'd like to pick up on that, actually, because it ties in with my next question as well. You highlighted in your comments that part of the basic income will be monetary, will be a monetary payment, and part of it will be a a non-monetary infrastructure that is being provided. And with respect to what Vanna has said, referring to that, are there any struggles, or what about the struggles for access to infrastructure and for infrastructure? In Germany, for example, we see the struggles for housing and the struggles for affordable housing. There could be struggles for mobility, for public transport, for example, or maybe even to some extent housing that could be offered on a non-monetary basis. Are you also part of these struggles? Or what are the reasons why do you advocate and work to bring about non-monetary infrastructure? the provision of non-monetary infrastructure.
The operators are doing really a great job, and I hope I don't speak so much. So I think it's important to implement in what we call unconditional autonomy allowance, not only money, cash, because we cannot eat money. We cannot heat the flat in the winter with money. We cannot have food with money. We can do it if we organize ourselves to be able to provide it to everybody. And it's also a part of this question to decolonize our homo economicus imaginary. So please let me present quickly what we speak about in the book, how to implement unconditional autonomy allowance, step by step. How could we imagine a transition from this model of society to new types of societies where we have a different level of economic system, which could be based on money and based on different type of other things, like Karl Polanyi say, a society of markets and not a market society. So as I said, first, we should start from grassroots movements. And in fact, you can already see in our society that there are a lot of different type of alternative economic system far away from the market economy. We spoke about the women, all the things which are made by the women, all the tasks which are made by the women and also some men sometimes. I hope men here are helping also in the house and stuff like that, are not inside this market economy system, are not calculated inside the GDP. And there are a lot of things like volunteer job in NGOs and so on, which are not calculated inside the GDP. And also all the concrete alternatives are not calculated inside the GDP and this dominating economic model. And we have to extend step by step these things. So we have to say that there are things which are too much important to don't let it in this crazy idea of invisible hand of the market. It's nonsense. That's why we have to extend the part of things which should be outside of the market for free. Why should we pay the same price, the liter of water, what we use to drink, to wash dishes, to cook, or the liter of water, what we use to wash a pickup truck, to fill our individual swimming pool, to water the golf where we play on the weekend with our friends and smoking the cigar and so on. And we have to question this type of things. And step by step, from grassroots movement, with also trying to reach critical mass of people fighting for that, making pressure on decision makers against the lobbies, questioning property rights to reappropriate the usage, to reappropriate the common goods. Step by step, not with a strategy to take the power, because if we take the power, we'll be taken by the power, but with a strategy to fight against the power, we should extend these concrete alternatives, these local initiatives, transform the society. But that's not enough. That's really not enough, because first, we will find only people like us, and a big part of the people won't be involved in that because they are still sticked in the fear, economic fear, and advertisement, and a lot of things, dominating tools which are letting them outside of this thinking and implementation and transition and so on. So one thing which could be interesting, a first step, what we think could be interesting to go to a degrowth society is the implementation of basic income and after unconditional autonomy allowance, could be to fight to have a decentralized reform to work less. And really something decentralized coming from the people. Like we should implement, for example, the right to go to our boss and to say, I want to have a part-time contract. I am an engineer, I don't want to have a full-time contract. No, if I do that as an engineer, it's quite likely that I will be fired. It will be refused. So to have this type of reforms, which could be decentralized coming from the people, to have a chance to work less, to have a better life, to have more free time, to keep going on the transformation of the society, which is coming from grassroots movements. A step after that, which could be interesting, and it's technically very easy to implement, it's just a question of political will, it's just a question of social pressure, could be the implementation of basic income. But we think in the degrowth movement in France, I mean, there is quite a wide consensus on that, it should be implemented, connected to a maximum income. So in our book, we speak about a ratio from 1 to 4 between the minimum income and the maximum income. And to implement also a maximum income step by step, that we don't start with a ratio from 1 to 4, but we can start with a ratio from 1 to 1,000, and we reduce it step by step and so on. And also connected to reappropriation of a lot of economic tools. Audits, public audits, democratic audit on whether we pay back the public debts or not. I think we shouldn't pay back the illegitimate parts of the public debt. And also democratic reappropriation of economic tools. Money creation, central banks, bank system, a bigger control on finance and so on. And we can go with society, which is changing from grassroots movement, different type of reform going on with social pressure on the decision makers against the lobbies to reappropriate more and more the public spaces, public money, the law, and also to question the property rights. And we can say that we give unconditionally from birth to death, just an example, 1,000 euros to everybody. And we are here in Leipzig. In Leipzig, in the same time, some people implemented a local currency with local food production, which is enough to feed almost all the population in Leipzig with a network of organic farmers around the city, community gardens, urban gardening, and so on. And with that local currency, we don't get anymore 1,000 euros per month, but let's say 750 euros per month plus the local currency. Also in Leipzig, where we are here, or let's say in this region, was implemented a different type of organization of water prices. So you get for free enough liters of water for a usage that we democratically consider as a good usage of water, to drink, wash the dishes, wash yourself, and so on. So you don't get any more 750 euros plus local currency for food, but you get like 600 euros local currency for food and a certain number of liters of water. And step by step, in a decentralized way, depending on what's happening in different regions in the world, in different cities and so on, and based on local movements and local initiatives and based on politics actions, we can imagine a transformation of society and to go to a society of markets on different levels, when we could still have like euros, supranational currency, national currency, regional currency, local currency, and other different type of local economic system. And it could be a strategy, and just ideas what we develop in the book to open debates and also open our brains and mind to think and to reappropriate some hope. It could be one strategy to step by step question, what should be inside the market economy? What should be outside? What should be in currency? What, and to step by step transform the society to question, what do we produce? How do we produce it? For what kind of use? And there won't be only one pass, only one transition, but there will be as many transitions as there are initiatives a bit everywhere in the world.
Yeah.
Thank you very much, François. And we've now heard so many different aspects. And now you probably have questions or maybe comments. You'll see two people with the mic. So please raise your hands for those who have questions. Please also mention to whom you're addressing your question. Hello, my name is Andrea Salam from GreenNet Project. My comment is directed to Werner, first of all. I was quite astonished by your struggle, Harriet, just now. Because the way I see it, struggle is a resonance of two poles. A resonance creates a counter resonance. And I'm only talking for myself. Maybe others have a different perspective. But let me just tell you what I think. I would like to encourage everybody to strengthen their own cycles and go along with what Vincent has just said. Because we should destroy the current structure by doing things differently. And this is the way forward, I believe, instead of the struggle. Nevertheless, the unconditional basic income is an elementary precondition to that what can happen in change. And there are two questions or two remarks which I want to show in the audience here. And I just want to know what you think about it, because I don't have too much knowledge on that. Now, the first question is, how do you deal with the various spaces globally? For example, how do you measure the value or the amount of the unconditional basic income in a, for example, in a society or in a country which is a bit disadvantaged? So how do you set the unconditional basic income given the various different situations in countries? And secondly, a party. Now, do you think a political party can propagate unconditional basic income? Do you think you might maybe want to develop a political party that would propagate that, what we are demanding, the unconditional basic income? So what we're going to do, we collect questions first before we ask the panelists to answer.
Frauen werden dann vorgezogen. Also erstmal du.
Dankeschön. Ich kenne jetzt diese Debatte um das bedingungslose Grundeinkommen schon seit vielen Jahren. Ich finde auch die Argumente super und auch, ich finde es auch gut, dass ihr über die verschiedenen Ausgestaltungsmöglichkeiten streitet. Habe jetzt mal eine ganz grundsätzliche Frage, und zwar möchte ich ganz gerne mal von allen dreien dort vorne wissen, wie sie denn einschätzen, warum das nicht weiter tatsächlich in der politischen Debatte von den eigentlichen Akteuren ankommt, warum das so nicht aufgenommen wird. Selbst das bedingungslose Grundeinkommen, wie es Straupaar fordert, denke ich, könnte durchaus möglicherweise ein Schritt in die richtige Richtung sein. Und aber auch das findet keine Resonanz im politischen Bereich. Und die Frage ist halt, warum an euch? Und außerdem möchte ich ganz gerne wissen, was der nächste erste Schritt sein könnte, um da tatsächlich ein bisschen mehr Sichtbarkeit mit dem Konzept mal wieder zu erfahren.
Interpretation in English. Okay, jetzt bist du da oben. Da oben der Herr.
Sorry, Vincent, the question, Vincent, do you hear me now? Okay, sorry. The question was, what could be first steps to make the concept more visible? Because it's not debated in politics. Politicians don't take it up. Okay, I'm from Fernopoli, the next questioner now. Now, with regard to the previous question, what do you say to those who say that basic income is something like opium for the revolutionaries? Because you can debate the concept, but the strategies to get there are actually very controversial. So we can debate for years whether we want or actually can have a minimum wage, but at the national level, but there's not much to be expected at international level. We cannot expect much from attempts to tackle climate change, for example. So how, or you know, having said that, how can you possibly expect that we could come to an agreement when it comes to unconditional basic income? So can we actually, are these actually issues we can debate effectively and come to an agreement on? I think it's about time. Now that we have come together and we are together striving for change, we have to get more concrete. What are, and look very seriously at what are the obstacles and what are the stumbling blocks that we are facing? Why can we not advance? Mm. why can we not make headway?
Okay, thank you very much. It was very interesting. I have a question with regard to financing. I'd like to know how you expect the basic income to be financed, and especially when we look at income and infrastructure, then there will be, of course, conflicts with regard to the financing. And I'd like to find out what are the conflicts vis-à-vis the financing, and also how to overcome and solve these conflicts. Okay, one more question here at the front. I have two questions. One to Werner first, one referring to the struggle that we were talking about earlier. I'd like to find out whether you have little hope with or trust with the argument of the unconditional basic income. Do you think we need to fight for these arguments, because why do you believe that these arguments who speak in favor of unconditional basic income, why do you think that they need to be, why do they need to be fought from the grassroots in order to convince the politicians? Now, my question is, other question is to Vincent.
You pay it in local currencies. What are doing the people at the borders of currencies that are local? Because from my perspective, it's excluding somehow even neighbors that are living at the borders of different local currencies.
Weitere Wortmeldungen noch? Wir können noch zwei nehmen. Ulrich?
Ja, eine Anmerkung zur Strategie.
One question with regard to strategy. We really have to think about how we can go small steps in order to reach our actual goal to secure unconditional income. We cannot expect to have such a goal already the day after tomorrow, because this is a huge step for the society, for the culture, and also for the readiness to work. We can only bring about that change, that cultural change, in small steps, and for that we need to develop concepts. Now, the other point I want to mention refers to the question of combining it with degrowth. So far, I think that was not touched upon too much. Yes, Werner said that consciousness, awareness changes with struggles or within struggles. Yes, of course, I can imagine that. But the question is, who fights? And that is only 1% of the society. Of course, there are struggles, and I'm not against struggles. We don't need to do it with weapons, of course. And with struggles, you learn something as well. However, it's only a small share of the population who's prepared to struggle. Now, what about the other part of the population? Now, why should basic income lead to consuming less? There are reasons for that. However, why would that necessarily lead to degrowth? I'm talking here about unconditional basic income. Why would that necessarily lead to degrowth?
Dann seid ihr beide noch dran, und da muss ich leider schließen, weil.
Okay, we'll take two more questions, but we're a little bit short in time, so these are going to be the last two questions. The debate is very interesting. I'm not sure whether I know enough, but my question is, how can that be financed, and what is the research? What is the that backs up all these concepts? I mean, these proposals that have been put forward, I'm not sure about, for example, just letting the waste and the garbage lie in the street and expecting that someone eventually will take care of the waste. I'm really not sure about that. But how will society organize itself in a productive way with unconditional basic income? And what is the research that backs that up?
Okay. Now, for me, the ecological aspect is missing in the unconditional basic income debate. What I would like to see there is that people who are debating that should take more consideration of the ecological aspect. At this conference, I looked at the various information tables and looked at the ideas maybe that are not represented in the panel. There's an idea of an ecological income, and maybe we should think about what that could mean. There's an idea of if you speak about reforms, and for me, an unconditional basic income would be a reform question, actually. Now, it would be also interesting to talk about the resource tax. So, for example, if you say that you want to siphon wealth, you have to also think about where do you get that wealth? How do you levy tax on these resources? Now, with regard to the unconditional basic income debate, I really would love it to see it being combined with other debates and initiatives. Now, was it a question to all? Well, what we're going to do now, we will first try to answer questions that were addressed to specific individualists. Panelists, we had first a question about struggles and steps ahead, and these were questions to Werner Hels. And then the second question was to Vincent about the regional currency. Well, okay. I will talk about the struggles and then answer the other questions as well in one go. Now, I will say the following. There should be a party which is fighting for the unconditional basic income, and I hope that the unconditional basic income does not become a political project for a long, long time, because if one party comes up supporting this initiative, then you will find that all the other political parties will be against that. So currently, I think it's good that in all parties, there are streams that are in favor of unconditional basic income who are trying to push that in. There are parties in the left parties more than maybe in the conservative parties, and with the Greens also, that debate is not that strongly there. But in all the party landscape, you find it somehow. Now, the second point that I want to make is that unconditional basic income is not an opium for the opposition. That basic income is the thing that leads to social struggles. And a step-by-step introduction is the way ahead, and this is what we are propagating as well. So now, with regard to financing, let me say the following. What you want to finance in a rich world is possible to be financed, because in a rich world, that is just a question of political will. Now, if we look at the debate on unconditional basic income, the question of the struggle, of course, I know that you can't just not pick up nuclear waste, and because you cannot ignore nuclear waste, the struggles emerged, because there were people who said, like, the nuclear waste has to go away, and the people started to struggle. And these are the people who have been in the anti-nuclear movement. They've been fighting. So this shows that it's not easy just to do things differently and to think of other cycles. Now, if we don't interrupt the nuclear waste cycle, that would be deadly for our society. We should not just wait. We have to fight. We have to make sure that nuclear waste is cleared from our planet. And the same struggle we will be faced with the unconditional basic income. Now, what we want to do with regard to financing is that we want to take away part of the money from those who are making a lot of money, the businesses.
We have a very good argument for the introduction of UBI. It is to completely transform the way we do business. Currently, our current model is based on capital accumulation, the accumulation of capital. And this is what we want to get rid of, because currently money is used to create more money. And that is something we want to get rid of. We want to get to a point where people are able to say, well, I couldn't care less. I don't want to work for you anymore. Because this is at the heart of capitalism. And if we attack the heart of capitalism, we should not be fooled, or we should not fool ourselves, because there will be resistance by capital. But we have to think about appropriate responses to those resistances by capital. So this is what we're doing at the moment. This is what we're doing. And this also answers the question, why so few people actually join our struggles? It is precisely because it is about everything. Our struggles are about everything. But I am convinced that they will, that capital will strike back with everything it has. So it is basically a struggle about everything, and we have to be prepared that capital will be furiously attacking us in resistance. You're not. I see that you're not satisfied with my answer. Okay, we're very short in time. I could go on speaking about it, but I want to give others the opportunity to say something as well here. Not, don't want to take away too much time, okay? Vincent, let's get to the issue of regional currencies. Vincent, you have the floor.
I will try to answer to this question and also a lot of other questions what you spoke about as well, because the first things I want to say is that basic income, unconditional autonomy, allowance, maximum income, and all the things I spoke about, for me, are only tools to deeply, culturally transform the society and to get rid of these homo economicus principles. And also with the question which was asked about the conflicts, it's to question how can we change the model of society in a non-violent way, to question the property rights in a non-violent way, to reappropriate the usage of the commons and the common good, to question how can we find different type of tools on different levels to go to autonomy, to relocalize as much as possible our productions, to reinvent new types of local economic system which should be convivial and autonomous. We have a democratic control on it. To question, to invent how to implement direct democracy in a local level. And to answer your question about exclusion between the region and other things, so the next book we started to work on will be about what we call open relocalization. That on one hand we have to relocalize our productions, our economic system, because of environmental effectiveness, obviously, but also because of a lot of other reasons. And as the world has been globalized, and there are a lot of strong technical interdependencies everywhere on the world, we need to do it in an open way. And we need to do it with dialogue between the regions, between the different parts. We need to do it with solidarity. We need to do it in meeting each other, exchanging on experiences, on the mistakes we could do, on the different type what we implement, which works, doesn't work, and so on. And the question is, I think, when we will be able to implement a basic income or unconditional autonomy allowance. It means that when the people in the society will be, there will be a critical mass of people in the society which will be ready for such a big change. I think we won't need it anymore. The society will already be changed. And to start to speak about basic income, it's to start also to implement discussion about why do I wake up in the morning to go to work? What is a meaningful life? What do I produce? To speak about unconditional autonomy allowance and this idea how to share the water, how to produce the water in another way. What could be as public services about school and health? It's the main goal is much more to think open discussion, public deliberation about the meaning of health, schools, education, autonomy, conviviality, our production, our economic system, and so on. And I think that degrowth with all the tools, whether we implement them or not, it's really about to change deeply, culturally, the society, and not only technically. Because it's not enough to change technically. Society, a tool is just a tool. A basic income and unconditional autonomy, the other ones are just economic tools. You don't change a society with only tools. It could help, but you don't. It's not enough.
Margit, jetzt möchte ich dir als nächstes die Gelegenheit geben.
Margit, I'd like to give you the opportunity to answer the questions that were addressed to all. You have the opportunity to answer or not, or maybe to just few of them. Well, it's not very motivating, but I will give my best. I'll start with the question of party involvement, and I'll give you the Austrian point of view. In the parliament, we don't have a party that is in favor of basic income. We had one party that was in favor of a citizen payment, and that had a lot of elements of unconditional basic income. However, it was very clear that in the liberal demand that if there is a basic income, then we shouldn't also provide non-monetary infrastructure. It means also that educational fees should not be paid. Now, the Communist Party in Austria is in favor of unconditional basic income. However, it does not have a parliamentary seat. Now, what I see now is that parties that are discussing on the topic of unconditional basic income, they have different values. For example, if parties take on a basic income approach, then they won't discuss the real basic income. They only take certain aspects, so it becomes a little bit distorted. So I see certain parties maybe who would take on this demand seriously, such as the Green Party. They, for example, the Green parties are asking for a basic security or basic income, and where they wouldn't ask people what they are planning to do with their income. So it's about values, basically. Another point is that across all political parties, and it's possibly the same in other countries as well, there are many people who are in favor of the unconditional basic income. That's the same with trade unions and also the church. However, the support becomes less in sectors or in spheres who have the right to interpret and define. Because in this sphere, the people are saying, well, it's just an illusion, it's a nice illusion. And I believe that support is so little among these groups, it's because it will reduce their power. And I think it's a good thing is that the discussion on unconditional basic income is a long debate. It's a debate that has been going on for years and years. And the basic income is a topic that is suitable to really tackle the current issues. For example, when we look at unemployment, structural unemployment, or if we look at issues concerning environmental problems. So that unconditional basic income debate brings in all these social problems that one can discuss. But unfortunately, this debate is not going the way I would like it to go. Now, with regard to the ecological aspect, basic income was thought at a time when growth was increasing. I have a colleague at my institution published a lot of books. Now, let me talk about one more thought, which I find very important because it leads towards post-growth back then. There's a thought that states that basic income embodies the idea that everybody who is on this earth has the right to have a share in the commodities on this earth. This is the right of every human being on this earth, and that can help if we understand basic income as an incentive to handle or to deal with this resources on this earth well. Now, of course, when it comes to financing, maybe we should levy a tax on certain resources. Of course, we could continue with our debate. However, I can see that some people are leaving the lecture hall and it's already 9:30 and we have to come to an end. Maybe Werner and Vincent, you would like maybe to respond to questions and then we can maybe finish the session so that we can enjoy the rest of the evening.
Dann sage ich die zwei Sätze an die Kollegin, die eben nicht zufrieden war. Noch hoffentlich bist du dann.
Okay, then let me respond to the issue that was raised before. Margaret actually said a lot of things that I can support. UBI is a thing that will shake up our circumstances and shake up the status quo. So we can look at it from the perspective of the individual as well. I go around organizing seminars and giving seminars about UBI. And when we are maybe 20, 30 people in one seminar, and we have breaks in between, people actually come together and they start seriously thinking about what would I do in a world with UBI. When people start thinking about how could I change my life, what is necessary for me to live my life in a different way, what kind of tool, what kind of instrument, what kind of conditions are necessary. And for the elites, for those in power, these thoughts and these movements are very dangerous. And the reaction to the UBI proposal is always the same. And those in power share the same interests, and that's why they always show the same reaction or respond in the same way to the proposal of unconditional basic income.
Relation between basic income and
spoke about it. So to conclude, because it's time to conclude, and I think we can continue with a beer in the courtyard, which is much more comfortable than with Audi Max. And I think basic income and all the ideas we spoke about tonight and are part of degrowth thinking, and the degrowth is really to make a huge transformation of the society, to switch to new paradigm. And if you look at history, it's a type of transformation which takes time and which are not easy. And I think in our societies we are facing a lot of contradictory dynamics. On one hand, there are a lot of things which made me very, which are making me terribly pessimistic. We have an oligarchic elite who don't understand anything about what's happening around, who is only protecting its own interests. There is a political elite which is serving these oligarchs, and they are stronger and stronger. They are dominating the institutions, the police, the armies, and so on. We have very terrible challenges, environmental, energetic, ecological challenges to face very soon, which makes me terribly pessimistic. And on the other hand, there are what's happening around in this university, in all the movements which are connected to degrowth, post-growth, transition, I mean, you call it as you want, but there are strong dynamics of more and more people who are questioning this model of society, who understood that it doesn't make sense anymore, that it's unsustainable, and try to experiment new ways of life. And discussion we had tonight about basic income, about what is around, about unconditional autonomy at once, about what could be a degrowth project, participates to reappropriate this hope in spreading a lot of seeds in the society. Putting a lot of seeds in our brain to understand what's happening around, to reappropriate hopes in proposing other things, a lot of seeds to reappropriate tools, economic system, experiment locally different new ways of life, which could be more sustainable, desirable, more democratic, to reappropriate freedom and so on. And history is neither predictable nor linear. We don't know what could happen. And I think in opening these debates, it's not to find the magical tools or the magical program to implement right now a change in society, because it doesn't exist, but start to implement some dynamics in the society, spread these seeds, and hope that when we will face some conditions which will be favorable for these ideas, these seeds could grow and could make nice flowers. And that's the only hope I think we can have, to resist as much as possible, reappropriate new ways of life, try to reappropriate discussion, solidarities, new tools, and so on, and hope that the violence which are already starting, the tragedies, the catastrophes which are already going on around in our societies, will be the less violent as possible. So thank you very much.
Well, we haven't answered all the questions in detail, unfortunately. However, the discussion is open. I have one question to the panelists. I'd like to ask you to make one single sentence and tell us how do you, when it comes to degrowth and social security in the form of unconditional basic income, how do you assess that? Do you see any common points, commonalities? Do you see any differences? So degrowth and basic unconditional basic income, give us one single sentence on that. How do you see the relation between degrowth and unconditional basic income? Well, an unconditional basic income gives us the possibility to discuss the things without a fear that is needed for a good love and how to produce them. And only this debate will make sure that we have an ecologically sound society and world.
In the meaning of Cornelius Castoriadis, and it's what we put in the title, unconditional autonomy allowance. So to reappropriate direct democracy and the meaning we want to give to our lives in being able to be citizens, willing to able to define individually and collectively their own laws.
Das ist letzte Wort.
Ja, ich von Werner, du hast, glaube ich, gemeint.
Werner, you said that you think that the amount decides the fact whether the uncontributed basic income has an emancipatory potential. The amount was also a topic with Vincent when it came to the different levels of monetary services and giving autonomy through infrastructure. Now, what is very decisive at the moment in connection with basic income lies in the unconditionality, because that is there where we see most of the freedom.
Ja, vielen Dank euch dreien hier auf dem.
Thank you very much, you three panelists, and I'd like also to thank the audience for their stamina. I'd also like to thank everybody who has helped us put this or make this panel a reality. I'd like to thank all the helpers, the interpreters, and I'd like to remind you that tomorrow at 9 o'clock, helpers are still needed, so maybe you want to help and join them. So have a lovely evening. Good night.